To my right, the gentleman in the pink top, this is Varun Chawla, the co-founder of Built3, a startup studio for impact-oriented startups, and of 91 Springboard, one of the biggest co-working communities in India. Martin McKay from Denmark, located in Para since 2 years. He's a digital nomad since 18 years, works in e-commerce, high-ticket sales, high-end tour guide, as well as stand-up comedy for the Indian audience. To his left is Matt McIntosh, a freelance copywriter who has been a digital nomad for 6 years. He's interested in community building among nomads and connecting with local cultures. To my right again in the suit is Tejas Joseph, ex-entrepreneur and startup ecosystem enabler, currently serving as CEO of Fire Goa, which is the first and only tourism tech startup incubator in the country. To my left is Pankaj Taneja, graduate in electronics with a postgraduate degree in management with 27 plus years of experience in IT. He is successfully managing various online ventures in retail and travel in Europe. To my right is Ryan Prazeres, my good friend, an early stage entrepreneur from Panjim, Goa. He has a degree in business from Pune in London. Through his company OneBoard app, which you can all visit at stall number 55, he helps travelers find and book authentic and quality tours and activities. And last but not least is DS Prashant, to the extreme right, CEO of startup and IT promotions at Government of Goa. He has supported establishment of 2,000 plus micro enterprises, mentored more than 100 startups, and helped investments in 35 startups over the last 23 years in Goa. May I request you all to give them a big hand. Okay, so without further ado, I'll get straight into the panel discussion. My first question goes to Tejas. Tejas, would you be able to define tourism's tech, since it always gets confused with travel tech? I mean, when I was reading this, I also thought it was the same. So if you could just take that forward.
Take this glass bottle. There are startups which can make glass bottles which are cheaper than plastic bottles. And that falls under tourism tech for us. What does that mean is like any solutions, say for example sustainability, clean tech, mobility, waste management, provided it got an impact in a tourism geography. Now, if you take waste management, right? In any other metros, any other cities, the challenges we know, it's predictable. We know that, okay, this kind of waste will be there on a daily basis. Now, but when it comes to a tourism geography, that is different. Like, during season time, it will be, the surge of the waste will be there. Off season, it will be very less. So, the challenges in a tourism geography is kind of different from other geographies. And in India, nobody is talking about solutions related to tourism. And that is what we thought, since we have a proximity towards hospitality, travel, government, and even a lot of talents coming down to Goa, why can't we have an incubator that can support ideas related to tourism? 65% of directly and indirectly affecting the population of Goa is getting affected by tourism. So if you are not talking about that, who else can talk about that? So that was the context why we started this, and it's a long conversation, but when we started 3 years back during pandemic, it was already 30 months to the COVID, which means almost all lifestyle kind of entrepreneurs shut down their startups by that time, and only the serious ones stayed back. And this means when we decided to run an accelerator program along with Goa Tourism, we got applications from 6-7 countries. Some 55, 60 applications. And the only thing they told was that we don't need funding, we need business. So that's where, like, thanks to Jack, that time, the peak of COVID time, we did a business partner meet, and Jack hosted us at his property, where 12 to 15 startups came down across the country. And thanks to Sean, and by that time, Bitcoin was not an OSD or Jack was not a DTG incoming person. So thanks for being supportive from day one. And now Mark is sitting in the back, who is like more like a friend now, who guides me. And last 3 years, like this journey is with a few believers. And I'm not, you know, Prashant is the day one, that's a default, that's why I'm sitting here in first place. What I'm trying to tell you is like, if we don't convince the stakeholders in the ecosystem, we cannot build this whole thing. I can get innovations, or we can do all those things, but unless the stakeholders are convinced, government, hospitality, travel, even the local community, if they are not convinced, we cannot build this. At this point, I feel, you know, we have a chance to express this after 3 years. This means we have hit that point, or we have some glimpses, it can actually work in Goa. So that is what tourism tech. So that is something we are building out of Goa for the world. So nobody is using the word tourism tech in the country. So that means we are actually creating a vertical out of this. One request is like anyone thinking of starting something new with innovations, or you are if you are part of hospitality and travel, there's a small incubator in South Goa called FIRE with a double I, FIRE, and we have 70 to 80 startups related to tourism tech which are working right now. Would like to connect and discuss how they can, you know, do business with the stakeholders. Thanks.
Thank you Tejas, for that detailed explanation. It's great news that we have these incubators in Goa, and I would request all young entrepreneurs to give it a shot there, try them out, as well as I would also request my fellow industry colleagues to help with these pilot projects in whatever way. I have worked with Percept or Persistence a little bit with in trying their QR codes. My next question goes to Matt. Who all come under digital nomads, and what's the present scenario with digital nomads?
Sure. Okay. Can you hear me? Yeah, I would broadly define a nomad as anybody who is working and traveling at the same time. But in that concept, there's a broad range of people. There are people like me who don't actually have a home and been drifting for a long time. There are some people who may just have 8 home days and do it 3 months out of the year. There are fast travelers. The fastest traveler I met was somebody who moved around once a week, which I don't think is sustainable on any level. I'm a slow traveler. I tend to stay as long as the visa will allow, so that's usually 3 to 6 months, and that gives me time to really dive into the local culture, get some ties, really connect with people, and then I'll often return to places that I've been before because I make friends there and I really connect with the community, and in certain cases I spend a lot of time in Latin America, so I learn Spanish. As far as the current state of digital nomadism, I talked to Drew, who is the owner of Alphaman, the co-living home co-working space that I'm staying at, and he told me that current estimate is that there are around 35 million digital nomads in the world, with about 10% of them active in any given moment, so about 3.5 million. The gender breakdown is about 40% women, 60% men, mostly from the United States and EU countries. People take advantage of the cost of living differential, and it really makes a difference. It seems to be growing. It's grown. Of course, there was a dip during COVID. I'm one of the BC nomads, one of the before COVID nomads. But once COVID hit, people had to hunker down and stay in one place. It really wasn't a good idea to travel. But then once travel started picking up again, there were all of these people, companies that were used to having people work online, and many of them didn't require people to go back to the office. So that created a whole new crop of digital nomads, and I believe Drew says it's growing at a rate of about 15%, and has been for the last 4 years, so it's definitely a growing thing.
Thank you, Matt, for those insights. My next question will go to Prashant. What are the upcoming initiatives being undertaken by government to promote Goa as a global hotspot for digital nomads and tech-savvy students?
far as the government is concerned, you know, we have been hearing right from the morning panel, they're looking at the three E's. Economy, employment, and environment. So, the question is, what's going into the new economy? What's going into the new future? So we are looking at the workforce, we are looking at the workspace, and we are looking at how the whole transformation in the economy is happening. So Matt spoke about the growth of digital nomads, and it's estimated that by 2035, we'll be having 1 billion digital nomads in this world. So that's going to be a huge disruptor in the economy, and we have to be aware of that, and we have to work towards that. So we are trying to develop a program known as Digital Nomad Program, wherein we are trying to facilitate, not build anything special, but as government we are facilitators. We are trying to facilitate and see how we can make it easy for digital nomads to travel down from across the globe. Because at this point of time, India is not looked upon as a digital nomad destination. Even though Goa is seeing some digital nomads staying and working out of Goa. And we are seeing some infrastructure coming out by way of co-working spaces and co-living spaces. The whole idea is how we strengthen this over a period of time. Can Goa play the role of being a conduit, being a space where digital nomads from across the globe can come in, start working out of Goa, and then spread from across to other parts of the country from Goa? Because Goa can be supported in multiple ways, like controlling director, cultural shock, and other aspects. Goa is well tuned as a space for tourism, etc. So that's the first part. Second part is employment. Now, as the government, we are also very much keen to understand how to improve the employability of the local ecosystem. One way of looking at this digital nomad sector is to see how we can bring in the best of talent from across the globe. Because in the days to come, it will be a global talent which will be available to the best of industries. People will be looking at not just talent locally, but talent from across the globe, because people will be working out from any space. So once this talent from across the globe is coming to Goa, they will also be brushing shoulders with the local ecosystem, local talent, and the local talent will also get exposure and understand, you know, what it takes to build great companies and global companies and how to be the best of employees. So we understand that having digital nomads will also help in the economy. The third piece which you are looking at is the environment, because the world is very conscious. Today we have been talking about sustainability. We have been talking about, you know, having glass bottles and not having plastic bottles. Everybody is talking about sustainability. ESG is going to be, you know, the prominent factor. And working remotely, digital nomad, IT industry was one of the cleanest industry at present. So I think it ticks all the boxes. And for Goa, it looks ideal to, because it's going to be a plant of tourism and IT sector. So we are looking at this sector with wide eyes and with a lot of expectations. And we are playing our role to be a facilitator.
My next question will, thank you Prashant first for the question, will go to Varun. So I grew up in the Kampal area, and one of the stunning things for me to see was a building which was never had life, come to life when you started 91 Spring Boom. So thank you for that, for taking that initiative. And the question I have is, why Goa is the hotspot for digital nomads? And what's been your experience with 91 Spring Boom? And now with Bill 3.
So you're not going to hear the answer you want to hear from anyone's report. It didn't come from a place where we wanted to sort of promote digital tourism or digital nomadism in Goa. It came from a place that me and my co-founders would meet every month and have a strategic chat on what was going well or not going well in the business. And this one time we sat down and we used to have a headquarters in Delhi. My co-founder Pranay was saying, look, 5 of my team members have typhoid. I'm like, oh, that's not nice. We'll fix the water supply in the building. Which building? He says across 3 buildings. Conversation keeps going on. Some people have chikungunya, some people have dengue. Average commute times in the city are 2 to 3 hours per day. Air pollution is nuts. Cost of living is crazy. All in all, quality of life in big cities is not so exciting in India anymore. So as an employer, what can we do to make employment nicer, more pleasant, more productive, more enjoyable for our team? That was the driving factor. That's what took us to Goa, because when we said Goa, after Delhi, Bombay, Bangalore, Hyderabad, Pune, these are the main cities. After this, if you say Goa, people's eyes are like, tell me more, I'm interested. We were able to pull people from across the country, not necessarily overseas, but our first year that we moved to Goa, we hired 100 people. 1/3 came from Goa, 2/3 came from outside of Goa. So it's pretty exciting to have some young talent in Goa, but also we were able to pull from everywhere. That was amazing. I can confirm to you that every one of our team members said they were either more productive or they were happier, and they were definitely more energized. So Goa has that quality, and it's been an amazing decision for us. That said, 3 years ago I started a new business called Build3, which is what I'm representing today. That has a co-living and co-working aspect also, and that was really around, we were serving the Goan startup ecosystem, which is still emerging, still young, and will take a while to reach the levels of say a Bangalore or a Bombay or a Delhi, but it's growing. One of the things to enable an ecosystem is bring partners from other cities where there is buoyancy. And if you want to bring them, give them a place to stay. So we start to invite people, give them a place to stay, mingle with local Goan entrepreneurs, knowledge exchange happens, partnerships happen, funding relationships happen. So some of that excitement has happened, and I'm glad to say Goa has been an amazing place to facilitate that. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Varun, for those insights. So I think the key factor, like Varun said, is basically quality of life, and that is what remains a big draw in Goa. My next question is to our local boy, Ryan. Why Ryan has taken the plunge to get into tourism tech? So why Goa can be a test market for tourism tech for India, and what are the favoring factors in Goa that you find to the tourism tech?
Thanks, Jack. Good afternoon, everyone. A little brief about Moneyboard and what we do. We are a travel tech startup with the goal to help travelers find and book authentic and quality experiences in Goa. Why Goa? What, besides it being my hometown, what is so exciting about Goa that I left my job in London 7-8 years ago and I can move back to Goa? Firstly, travel and tourism is something that is very close to home. It's very close to everyone I know growing up. Tourism in Goa is abundant. Quality is present all over. One of the main factors I came back home personally was because of my know-how of the market, and I thought it would be a great space to sort of set up, network, and build a base out of Goa and take that to the world. 7-8 years down, it's been a journey, and a plunge to Moneyboard has been only 2.5 years in. But what is the main important factor, I would say, when we look at a market that we want to build in? The most important thing is the ability to be close to our customers. We want to be around a space which thrives in the industry we are looking to get in and disrupt it. Is it the right time? Is it the right opportunity? And what is that for everything tourism? We have from the best restaurants in the world, a numerous amounts of activities and tours is essentially what we do. Most people barely scratch the surface when they know what can be done in Goa. If you want to know more, go to our site. You'll see over 200 wonderful things to do in Goa. And besides the commercial stuff, we want to show Goa beyond beaches and bars. We have so much that can be done, so much that can be learned. Even dating back through our museums, walking tours, which give us so much insight through history. So, in that aspect, Goa is a great place to start up a travel tech startup, tourism tech startup, sorry. Also, what I feel is that talent is easily available in Goa. We have a lot of people, especially within the IT space, who are very much aware and attuned with the tourism space. So, not too much time is needed to be spent getting them educated and up to date with stuff other than IT. They know how customers think, how customers react, and it is a brilliant place to sort of build, test, reiterate, get feedback from your customers and immediately put it in. I think that's a super important factor when you're looking at tech, especially because you want to be able to get real market insights before you build on that. I think more or less, I think in a broader aspect and when it comes to tourism, all things hospitality, Goa is the perfect place. It definitely was exciting, and I can't think of anything, I can't think of having my base anywhere else but here. So, yeah.
So, from Ryan, we got that the feedback mechanism is quite fast in Goa, and there's a chance to pivot around and see what you can do. My next question goes to Martin. How does Goa compare to other digital nomad hotspots around the world? What can it learn from these places to enhance its attractiveness to the global nomadic community?
Thanks, Jack. What a great question. First, I'll just tell why I even got started as a nomad and why India, to kind of get perspective on it. When I first came to Goa in 2004, the cost of living was so less. I came here and I was met with nomads before they were digital. I don't know if you guys remember Goa in 2004. It was full of French, German, Spanish, Italians. They had long hair. They drove Royal Enfield motorbike. And they survived by selling some trinkets at the Saturday night market, Wednesday flea market. And I looked at them, they were maybe 25, I was 19. And I said, I want to be like that when I go. I want to live the free life, and I don't want to go home. And I got guest house for 100 rupees, scooter for 100 rupees, 3 meals for 150 rupees per day, and life was set. So the motivation to become a nomad was, live like this permanently. Then later on, I got into tourism, and I could support that. Then later on, I got into digital nomad with my first business. Now, the other nomads around that I guess Goa is trying to attract, digital nomads first, but their motivation is, I want to build my business, the ones I haven't met, and I want to, you know, get the most, lowest cost per living possible. The times that I've gone to other destinations, I was in Chiang Mai for 2 months, then another 2 months, I was in Bali for 8 months. Those times was because my Indian visa was over and I have to go. But when I went there, I was shocked. There's so many foreigners there that are living digital nomad life. One of the main differences is everything is set up, cost of living is low, and there is no competition from the local economy. Means when you go to Chiang Mai and you get a place, there's no local Thai people trying to get the same Airbnb. When you go to Bali, you live in Ubud, there's no Indonesians trying to go in the same co-working space. Those places have a parallel economy. All foreigners have their own thing, locals have their own thing. Goa is a magical place, but that is not the case. Goa has a thriving expat community. People from other parts of India that have come to Goa, that I know melting it into some pot. And that's the magic of Goa. I think the way we get foreigners interested in being digital nomads in Goa specifically, is you have to sell them on the idea of Goa, the magic of India. They have to also love it. They can't just come for the cost of living should be less and the co-working spaces are as good as they are internationally. It can't just be, oh, this is another place where you can, you know, save some money and build your business. It has to, you have to also sell them on India as a whole, and Goa specifically.
Thank you for the inputs, Martin. I think it corroborates with something I read a few years back where there was an article which basically defined Goa as India's happy place. That anyone who wants to come to Goa comes to Goa because they just get happy here. I think when people consider Goa to be lazy or criticize a Susegalo lifestyle, there is a great element of it. They think we are lazy. But it's not that, it's just a way to enjoy life and, you know, just have a good time, but at the same time work and have that work-life balance. So I think Martin hit that on the nail. We have to make sure we retain this part of culture to work in a relaxed manner and be conscious about doing it. My next question goes to... Can you share your experiences of interactions with the expectations of digital nomads? What would you say that the expectation is that you know that as well?
Yeah, if I talk about expectations, the person should be open to move to different places. So then more restrictions that you have to work in one particular place. Because what I've seen, I've come from Netherlands. I see a lot of people choose a different country, not Netherlands, they go to Portugal. Because weather is very important. Either they want to go to Spain. But Netherlands is always raining. Temperature is 8-9 degrees, people want sun. They go and work. Agents, the government and destinations are also very beautiful as compared to Netherlands. The person should be open to travel. Normally the other startups are also going. Maybe people from the startup, they are free, they are young, they want to. Because if they're not giving to the family, they can go and live anywhere and work with them. Other thing is the money. They save when they go and work, because when we talked about Netherlands, the cost of living roughly comes around 2,000 euros a month. They need to pay rent or if they need to pay for their food. When they go to different countries like Portugal, I think 600-800, they can manage the entire cost. And they can savings, they can put up in their business. Or in other things. So that's what I see, that a lot of culture is coming after Corona, because Corona has taught us how you can work in this digital arena, because now you have all the tools, you have very good internet, or you talked about you have all the online meeting platforms and other things. So that is going to help getting people to become digital nomad and across border, they can go anywhere and work in that.
Thank you for your inputs. So the next question goes to Varun, Matthew and Martin, any one of you can take it in any format you want. What role do local communities can play to attract digital nomads, since the dynamics across various regions are very different? So basically the differentiating factor is local communities. I'll start with one.
So I'll take the liberty of setting context. What can local communities do, but what can also say the government or other bodies do? Let me sort of address both. I think there's things that are better left to the government, like security, both like cross-border as well as within the city. So how do people feel safe? How do they get in and out of the country? How long they can stay? Visas, etc. Government. High quality communication systems, easy to get mobile SIM cards, etc. etc. This is part Thai and part local players, but a lot of it is the government. And then there is there's a third thing, which is monetary systems, which currency and banking is also largely regulated. If that can be made easier, then nomads can come in and transact and do a lot of that stuff. These three things, if the government and large organized players through regulation, etc. So I think that would be big. The rest is all entrepreneurs and communities locally should be doing, you know, co-living, co-working, meetups, investments, mentoring sessions, workshops, all sorts of things. Leave to entrepreneurs and the local community, and they do a fabulous job of it. There should be 10, 20, 50 things happening a month. Different people are trying different things. Some things will work for some people, some things for other people. And that potpourri is amazing. That creates a custom, I can find what works for me. It's not one size fits all. So I think all of those sorts of things, people like me and what you're doing and several of us are doing it different ways. It's important for us to do my flavor of it and you do your flavor of it, etc. Because we're not all built the same and we need these options. So that's sort of my broad view of things.
Sure, yeah. So I would say that the number one thing that I look for anytime I go to a new city is whether Wi-Fi is stable, because I'm not an analog nomad, unfortunately. I don't teach yoga or sell drinks on the beach, although that has its appeal. But it's not just fast Wi-Fi, because there are a lot of places in the world that have incredibly fast Wi-Fi, but it has to be stable and consistent. Or if you run up a living place or hotel or something like that, there need to be contingencies to make sure that it's consistent. So in Alcamea, the living place that I'm staying, they have two different sources of Wi-Fi. They also have a backup generator in case the power goes out. And the reason that's so important is because my clients don't care that I'm traveling the world. They actually think it's kind of cool, but they're not going to think it's cool if I can't meet with them and their clients because the internet cuts out or the power's out. So that's absolutely vital, not negotiable for me. And different places have done it in different ways. I was in a co-living place in Mexico, in Oaxaca, where they had Starlink, so they had satellite internet, and then they had fiber optic coming in as well. And you know, one great thing that Go has going for it is that it's got strong, or India in general has so much data, and so many cell towers, very inexpensive data. You can purchase large amounts of data. So in the rare instance that both of those contingencies fail with the Wi-Fi, I can go to the co-living place at the top of the roof and I can get 100 megabytes or higher. So that's not a problem here in Goa. I think one challenge that Goa has is that since a lot of us don't drive in foreign countries or are afraid to drive, I've been riding a scooter since I've been here, but I was terrified to drive on the left side of the street because I'd never done it before and I was afraid I wouldn't be able to learn. But a lot of people, that might be a barrier to coming to Goa because I didn't have Goa miles, but in Seligau where I'm staying, I hear it's hit or miss. Sometimes you can get a ride, sometimes you can't. So those are the practical concerns. As far as what will really draw and build a thriving community, like you mentioned, co-living is very different from hostels. Hostels are more 20-something backpackers who, you know, might get drunk every other night. Co-living tends to be 30s or older, and people who have jobs who are serious and want to work. And when you can combine co-living and co-working in the same place, that can really build a thriving community. There's an example of Atsco, Bulgaria, where they actually built a nomad community there from scratch. It was intentionally created. And what some people did is they noticed that it was very inexpensive for Europe, very expensive to stay there. You could get, at the time, the prices have gone up now, but you could get a one-bedroom apartment for $150. So they started a co-working community there, and provided everything people needed, strong Wi-Fi, that sort of thing. And then it grew from there, and now that same company owns their own co-living as well, and they've actually built this community where people are connecting. So there are various ways that entrepreneurs can do it. I do think there's a lot in that entrepreneurship that will attract people to a place. The other thing is to create opportunities to build community and connect with local culture. So one thing I love about Akamea is that about 15% of our guests are from various parts of India. I say our guests, not mine, but guests at the Living Place. And I know that as we're going into the low season for tourism, there's going to be a lot more Indians there. And I love that because I'm getting exposed to cultures all over this country. And that's a big reason why I travel. And you'll find that nomads tend to be very high in openness as a trait. So, yeah, anything you can do in the community, like language exchanges, cultural exchanges, things like that, that can really bring people together. And I think that's what builds something. And, you know, I noticed that all the people, even if you're a local, even if you've never left the city you're staying in, if you're in Medellin, Colombia, where I stayed for on and off for a year in my travels, I met a bunch of locals who just wanted to meet people from other countries because they were open and curious. And it was this wonderful mix of locals and people from all over the world. So I think that's what really builds and drives the community.
I'd like to just go into the question a little bit. The question is whether to, how to bring foreign nomads.
I'm saying if I have a local community, what can I do which will make it attractive for both foreign nomads, or it could even be nomads from elsewhere, from India. It doesn't make a difference as long as they... As a government, I'm looking basically to see how I can get economic development done.
So that's a great clarification, because for foreigners, we would exactly not direct much towards the local community. We would direct towards government and be like, guys, the visa thing is a bit difficult. And when we leave, if we don't have the proper visa, or even if we do, we get grilled when we leave. What are you doing? Why are you doing it? What are you doing here? You know, for other countries, you just waltz in, stay for as long as you like, come back, do a visa run. They don't even speak English, they don't care. But of course, India has its own security profile, and the government really is, not the government, but the visa situation would be the main thing that deters a lot of foreign travelers. Some of the things you mentioned as well, how do you get your two-wheeler? Goa is not a city, Goa is a state, you need a two-wheeler to get around. Is there a Wi-Fi ready to go in other downtowns, other power cuts? These are some things that nomads will ask themselves about, especially if they have an online presence job, like they have to be on Zoom calls several hours a day. You could lose your job if your Zoom call cuts out, you're just not cut out for this. So what can local communities do? As Matt was saying, having backup and one backup for the Wi-Fi, you know, so a Zoom call never ever cuts, having generators, inverters, that kind of thing. But also clearly defining this is a place for nomads, this is a place for people that are, you know, also holidaymakers. That's what happens a lot if you look for Airbnbs and go on. You definitely will be looking at planning outside of Indian festival seasons because 100% will be booked. So, you know, setting it up for nomads specifically will help a lot. But then also, the reason why I asked for the clarification is, if you were to survey a lot of digital nomads globally and ask them, would you like to spend 3 months in Goa? A lot of them might say, like, what's the visa situation? Is it safe? And have a lot of, you know, questions around that. But if you ask your average Indian working in a metro, they would say, hell yeah, I want to go to Goa for 3 months. So you have such a big amount of people that would love to come to Goa. And I think those are the people that are looking at your door and want to come down. I think building for the rainforest would be a better idea, and a better way for Goa to expand economically, if that is the goal.
So I think basically it comes down to largely that we are looking at stable Wi-Fi. There's also this big concern about security which has to be addressed. And if you're a foreigner, the question, the visa remains the major issue is what I got from those, from that interaction. My next question is to Tejas. What has been your experience as running a tourism accelerator program?
Honestly, Jay, as you know, it was an experiment. We tried it, we wanted to know whether this actually works or not. Now,
I don't want to get into all the assumptions and experiments we did for the last 3 years. But what I can tell right now, it's been 3 years, what we realize is like, say you, there are two assumptions we have. It takes minimum 10 to 15 years to create an ecosystem. We cannot bypass them. It takes time to build them. But we had glimpses in the last 3 years that this is going to work. Now, second thing is that when we did that session, event at your place, our assumption was, let's get all the stakeholders, let's get the relevant startups, now magically business will happen. It doesn't work that way. Now, what we realized is that after 3 years, there is an acceptance from the ecosystem saying that we are ready to experiment on new ideas, new innovations. But when we actually call the founders, they are not there to actually take up that whole challenge. So we were looking at one model where there's a B2B SaaS, if you want to do a business in US, there's B2B SaaS. You need one co-founder to actually stay in US. Like that's a life-changing decision. You have to make a co-founder to be there. Then only business will happen over a period of 2 to 3 years. So if that is the case, since we have all the stakeholders around a 60 kilometers kind of a radius, everyone is here. If you are not taking that life-changing decision of putting one co-founder and making them stay here, it's not going to work. So at least from our incubator going forward, we are going to make it mandatory that one of, not an employee, a co-founder actually has to be here and drive it, otherwise it's not going to work. So at least that's our assumption after 3 years, which we believe. So firstly, I believe talent attracts talent. So if that is the case, we need good talents to work out of this place which brings more people in, then the network effect will start giving. So maybe down the line another 2 to 3 years, if without say now one board is here, a couple of other startups are coming here, without knowing us, ecosystem players knowing, if they start helping each other, it will get to a critical point or a magic moment where things will work out in this ecosystem. And then we don't have to do anything, it's a private app as it is. For that, we need to bring more and more talents, and what else happens to them? Like, it takes 10 to 15 years at least for tourism tech to say as a mature thing, but the glimpses and the support we are getting from the ecosystem, we are sure that we are going to achieve. That's my experience from first accelerated day. To give some statistics other than from stories, so we have 75 startups we are supporting through our incubator related to tourism tech, and most of them are actually from out of Goa. Not based off Goa, but they're very clear with them. You have to come here if you want to do business in Goa. We cannot sit there and do it remotely. Or you'll be a digital nomad and do it from Goa. So that was the idea. And we kind of funded almost 1 to 2 crores through various schemes and funds we have to the startups. And I will give one classic example of what happened here, which is a variation for us. There's a startup which actually reduces the electricity bill in a hotel or in basically a commercial space. Then they came here, they realized that they cannot use that technology in a centralized place. Their entire model works with having individual ACs and billing. So they came here, they validated the idea, as you said, like they did the pivoting to actually capture 6,000 plus hotels in Goa. While they were doing it, there was a call for application from Singapore Tourism Accelerator, and we recommended them, and they got selected, and they are currently piloting there. So they actually came here. This is the model we are looking at. You cannot build a Series A company with thousands of employees in this place, but you can do your piloting, validate your idea, and build a global product there. So that was one of our assumptions got validated for 3 years, and the rest of us were experimenting there. We are trying to see, maybe down the line 2 to 3 years, we'll come and say that, hey, that was a wrong assumption and we did something else. But this experiment is going to happen more and more. And one thing we are very clear that we will never quit. We'll keep on doing this.
Thank you, Tejas, and thank you, gentlemen, for all your inputs. The floor is open to the audience for any questions if you have.
Specialists to all the panelists, what do you see or anticipate the future trends at this very interesting intersection of tourism tech, digital nomadism, and regenerative tourism?
If I talk about the tourism tech, today if I see
India is around $100 billion open market. If I say digital phone, only 20 million or out of 20 billion is, sorry, 20 million is only online. Rest all is offline. We are just working with tour operators or the taxi guys. So that will really will bring another change. So 30-40% increase we can see going into the digital. Going into next year, by 2030, we say 30-40% market will increase. For digital nomad, if you talk about, I think connectivity people have talked, I think more and more investment is needed in the creating an infrastructure. Internet connectivity plays a major role over there. If your connectivity is not there, how you will communicate with your customers or how you will communicate with the other community about it. So these are the two, three things what I see is going to increase going forward.
If you look at the technology space, you know, changes are going to happen fast. See, AI is going to be a $15 trillion economy by 2030. Just 7-8 years. Something like 5G, which we have not even touched today, is going to be another $15 trillion economy by 2030. Maybe Web3, emerging technologies, another $11 trillion. So, and all these businesses, which are going to become big businesses, are going to be driven by the extreme talents, sitting and working remotely. And those countries are going to benefit out of this, who are going to create the right ambience and space to attract this talent and work out of this. So, now, the intersection, if you look at it, it cannot be divided into sectors. If it is AI, AI is going to play a role in every sector. It is 5G is going to play a role in every sector. So this whole game of sector-wise differentiation is going to be, you know, destabilized or merged into some kind of a new sector, which is going to be the AI sector or the 5G sector. So I think we are looking at something which is dramatic, which is drastic, and creation of that whole ecosystem is going to be the key role there. And for governments, I think what we are looking at is we have to be very clear how it is going to play a key role for the local economy, for the local employment, and for the ecosystem environment. And whatever it takes to support, for example, the question of digital nomad visa, which Goa as a state is vying for, something which the government is persistently pursuing. So what a great infrastructure. The right space. We spoke about internet, stable internet. So we are running a program known as the Project Digital Nomad, whereby we are trying to aggregate all the spaces which are available in the co-working spaces, the co-living spaces, and so on. So that whoever is wanting to come to Goa will know these are the spaces which are available. At the same time, we are also trying to see how we can make it simplify and make it easier for them to play a role of interoperability. Say for example, somebody is coming to and staying in Mojing for 15 days and 30 days. Can they, after staying for 30 days in Mojing, go to Kanpur for another 15 days and stay there? And can they go to maybe the hilly areas of Uttarakhand where we already have a direct connection with the airlines and so on, and spend 2 months there or 1 month there, or go to Lakshadweep for another 1 month there? How can we facilitate this new kind of environment is something which the government needs to look at, the government is trying to do. So this is the whole change we are trying to bring. I think we are not very clear as what's going to happen. We are also dynamic, we are also being agile, as much as like a startup as far as the government system is concerned.
Thanks, Sean, for your question. One thing I said to myself is something I really believe is that post-COVID, when we started in the tourism space, this is going to be the decade of experiences. Some statistics was rightly spoken about is online penetration for travel, accommodation, transportation is roughly about 60%. But when it comes to experiences, activities, it's still less than 5%. And With that, what happens is there's a lack of quality and accountability for the existing infrastructure that exists today. Because today, people expect and are aware of quality. People want quality when it comes to food, when it comes to anything. The game is up. We want to be in the top. So, as that will happen over the next decade, we will have to make sure that quality and accountability will win. And there are a lot of supporting reports as well. One is the Indus Valley report, which was put out by Bloom, where they say that a lot of India 3 is now moving to India 2, and they've broken down India 2.1, India 2.0, which essentially divides people based on their income and demographics, to say that people today will slowly, or the medium salary will go up, and people, the younger generation, are looking to spend it. They're not looking to invest a long time. They're looking to have or experience a lot in their life compared to the previous generation. So yeah, that's something that I'm actually really looking forward to over the next couple of years.
Great question about the future. Future, such an interesting thing. If we could just see into the future, it'd be so good. One thing that the numbers that I like to look at about the future, regenerative tourism of the future. The average person in my home country is 45 years old. The average German is 47, the average Italian is 47. The average Indian is 25. If you want to regenerate through tourism, if you want to do any eco changes, build it for Indians, not for the foreigners.
Yeah, I'll just add to that your figure, you said like 2035 or 21 million nomads, and I think there are going to be more and more from different parts of the world, because it only makes sense that if you start paying people to work in different parts of the world, yes, there's some advantage if you hire software engineers in Bangalore versus California, but you're infusing those economies, you're raising people's earning power, and then over time, start to see more of an equalization of wealth and income, and that will generate more digital nomads. And I will say, even though the majority are from the EU and North America, I've met nomads from every continent where people live, so I see it growing. And I think COVID is a really interesting case study, because even though we could, companies could hire people to work remotely, the idea really scared them, and big businesses don't like to do things that scare them until they're forced to do it, which they were with COVID, and they realized, hey, this is possible. But I mean, it's such a global world. I mean, the majority of my clients are not in the U.S. I've got a number in Europe. My largest client, in terms of income, he provided 50% of my business, is a guy who runs a 500-person software development outsourcing firm in Chandigarh. So I'm actually going to meet him for the first time. We've been working together for 4 years, and I'm going to head up there. And it's amazing, because U.S. and European companies outsource their software development projects to him, and then he outsources his copywriting and content marketing to this crazy American who's ripping all over the world. So that's the future.
Data, and if we can make sense of that data, the ecosystem which is going to do that first is going to be this.